As we know, it is a cycle. Peace talks come, negotiations come, and then the war comes. You know, now it is now this phase is the phase of war, and this will lead to another phase of negotiations or a period without war. And that period without war, we have to convert it into a time period where we could help develop a permanent, long-lasting, just solution to the current issue. The situation is deteriorating very fast, I mean, in Sri Lanka. And say, my opinion is that the government or the LTT will not be able to achieve anything militarily. I mean, they won't succeed in either achieving a separate state or completely crushing the militant movement. So military situation will be stagnating, and then the economic situation will worsen, and then government will have to do something. And at that particular point of time, if the diaspora is willing to help and contribute, I think that would make a positive contribution. Say, so far what the diaspora has been doing is to contribute to the war. You know, sort of say, for example, I know the parties to the conflict, they collect funds in many different ways. Say, although the allegation is only against the LTTE, but I could say the same thing about the government. The government of Sri Lanka is collecting funds, you know, for their defense fund, you know, sort of. And when I was in Italy, I saw a public television interview by a minister, and in that broadcast he requested people to collect money to buy a MiG fighter, you know, sort of, so they can openly collect money. I mean, as diaspora, we should resist those trends, you know, because we are not here to help the war, right? I mean, some people will say war is the solution, but we know very well war is not going to bring a solution to this situation. It is not war that will develop a solution. It is the people of Sri Lanka, having developed a certain consciousness about the existing situation in Sri Lanka, about what is happening to the Tamil people and Tamil-speaking people, that includes Muslims, when they want to develop a solution, you know, that is when things will work, and the diaspora could contribute to that very positively, I think.
Great.
Instead of trying to build another Sri Lanka in whatever country they live, because we left Sri Lanka because of deteriorating circumstances in Sri Lanka, economically or socially or due to whatever reasons, politically, people left Sri Lanka. And to replicate that situation in these countries is, you know, I think it is a red herring. I think it has to be excluded at whatever cost. But some people, they try to do so after going overseas. Most of these people have experienced rich, positive aspects of their lives in those countries. For example, we fight for equal rights, and we want to be equal citizens to the others. And we value equal opportunities in employment, and we don't want to be discriminated. With that sort of experiences, to advocate special privileges for one particular community is, I think, I can't understand that situation. So one aspect diaspora could contribute is that way, you know, sort of advocating positive experiences and trying to help Sri Lanka to gain from that experience. That is one. The second thing is that they themselves can study the power sharing arrangements we have here. I mean, although in Australia, for example, we don't have different communities sharing power, we have state sharing power. And in Italy, for example, they have community sharing power. In Switzerland, they have community sharing power on ethnic basis. And in India, we have power sharing on an ethnic basis. So we probably, people in the diaspora could study those experiences and convey those experiences to Sri Lanka. Other thing is, we enjoy human rights here. We can say whatever we like. We can criticize the government. We can, you know, sort of criticize the human rights violations, or if fundamental rights are violated, we can go to courts. And if we are discriminated, we have a system where we can go to Equal Opportunity Commission and fight those things. And but we don't have similar things in Sri Lanka or, you know, sort of countries like that. So those sort of things we have to take into our consideration and probably pressurize Sri Lanka government, the government in Sri Lanka, to protect human rights, to protect fundamental rights of people, to protect media freedom. You know, sort of the, so I think diaspora can do so many things, and also diaspora can pressurize the governments here to initiate action, to pressurize the government of Sri Lanka to implement or rather protect human rights. Mm.